Good morning, friends. We are learning our subject that is data mining, and the subject code is 3160714. In that, we are learning our module 2 that is data pre-processing. So let us see the recall of our previous lecture. What we want to see there? Here we have seen the clustering algorithm, that is K-means clustering algorithm. What we do there? That is, we can say whatever n observations are there, that we are dividing into K clusters. Fine. And what we do for them, whatever data points are there, we are finding the mean or centroid of particular cluster or group and try to find whichever point is nearer to cluster centroids. To that cluster, we will move our data, right? And we'll stop when movement is not there. Fine. Okay. So now let us see that how we find the distance or how we find whether the point is nearer or far. For that we are using the distance formula, and they are of Euclidean distance as well as Manhattan distance. There can be other formula, but for our subject we will be using this too. Fine. So how to find the Euclidean distance? That is using under root of sigma I is equal to 1 to n qi minus pi whole square. Now this q and p, what are they? They are the points. They are say x1 y1, x2 y2. Fine. If we are having the Manhattan distance, we can say the formula is mod, that is the absolute value of the difference between y2 minus y1 plus x2 minus x1. Both the differences will be taking the absolute value of it, and then we'll be taking the addition. Fine. Let me first show you the handwritten example, so you can have the idea how it will work or how you will write it in your exam. Fine. So let me show you that. Here is the example. What is our aim? Data is given to us. For that, we want to create groups or clusters, right? For this particular example, it is given that we have to make two clusters. This was the example which was being asked in the mid exam of 2017, right? Okay, so now let me show you how it works, right? So first of all, what we have to do is, data is given, right? What is their subject, credit theory, credit practical? So subject names are say A, B, C, D. Credit theory is 1, 2, 4, 5. And credit of practical is 1, 1, 3, 4. Okay. We want to create two clusters, right? Data, whatever is given, is of 4 subjects. Okay. Now, what we want, that is centroid of cluster. Centroid of cluster, what we consider is, we want to create two cluster, right? Okay, so we have assumed that A 1 1 and C 4 3 are the cluster centroid. What we are doing is, first of all, randomly we have selected two centroids, right? Why two centroids? Because we want to make two clusters. Fine. Okay. So, what we do? Here, centroid of cluster 1. Four datas are given to us, right? So, first we have taken and third we have given. So, approximately, we have divided the data in two parts. Okay. Two groups. What we do is, A and B, we put in cluster 1 and C and D, we put in cluster 2. This is the assumption that A11, that is you can say credit theory and credit practical, that we are considering as the coordinates of our A. It can be many more, no issue for that, right? Because this is a small example, so only two coordinates are given. You can say two features are given or two attributes are given, right? For other example, it can be different also. So here, A11 is considered, assumed as the centroid of cluster 1, and C, that is 4-3, is considered as the centroid of cluster 2. Okay. So we should draw it inside this circle. See, shape, whether it is proper circle or not, that does not matter. Right. So do not worry about the drawing. Try to have the circle. Okay. And then, or people are using ellipse also. No issue for that. We have to write two points, that is A and B, in C1, and for C2 cluster you can say C and D are there. Fine. Now what we have to do is, we have to find the distance of each and every point from the centroid of cluster 1 and cluster 2. Very simple example is that. Let me say you this. If you do it properly, you can get full marks. It's very simple. Okay. Let us go ahead. Let us find the distance of B from A. Why distance of B from A? What we want is, we want to find the distance of data from centroid. Centroid what? Centroid of cluster 1 and cluster 2. So here the first data is B, right? Because A is already centroid, so there is no meaning of finding the distance of A with A, right? So we are considering the second point, that is B point. So how we can find the distance? That is, we will write it as distance, that is D of AB, that is equal to under root of, we know that we should consider y2 minus y1 whole square plus x2 minus x1 whole square, right? This formula, this is known to us, isn't it? So that's what we are doing. So 2 minus 1 whole square plus 1 minus 1 whole square, and that comes out to be 1. Fine? Okay. Now what we are doing here, we are finding the distance of D from C. Okay. Here we'll be finding the distance with C2 cluster. Here we are finding the distance with cluster 1. Okay. So let us see this a bit later. Let us see the B distance with cluster C2's centroid, that is C. So what we do is, distance between B and C. What we are doing is, we are finding the distance of data B from centroid C1 and centroid C2. Fine. So what happens, that distance of BC, that is equal to under root of 4 minus 2 whole square plus 3 minus 1 whole square, and that comes out to be 2.828. Fine? Okay. So, what is the case? Here, this is distance of A and B. That is, we can say, distance of data point B with centroid of cluster 1. And what is this? Distance of data B from centroid of cluster 2. And what we can say? Can we say 1 is less than 2.828? Obviously, that means that distance of data B is less than that of the distance of B with cluster 2. Here, this is the distance with cluster 1. This is the distance with cluster 2, right? So, this distance is less than that of this distance. So, what we can say is, we should put data B in cluster 1. Getting it? So, we should write it this way. That is, D of B and A is less than D of B and C, and so B remains in C1. Fine? Okay. So now let us proceed further. That is, now which data will come? C, isn't it? But C is already centroid. So should we find the distance with that? No, we should not. So we'll find the distance of D data, right? Okay, so distance of C with D. D is our data, right? You can write it as D, C, because distance of CD or DC is same, right? And if you want to write it uniformly, that is distance of D with C and distance of D with A, so that will look similar, right? Okay, you can write that, no issue. So distance of D with C, to make it similar for you, okay, that is equal to under root of 5 minus 4 whole square plus 4 minus 3 whole square, and that comes to be 1.414. Now we will find the distance of data D with the centroid of our cluster 1. That is our A point. So, under root of 5 minus 1 whole square plus 4 minus 1 whole square, that is equal to under root of 16 plus 9, and that is equal to 5. So, what we can say? Distance of D. Distance of D with C, that is cluster 2, is 1.414, and its distance with cluster 1 is 5. So which one is less? It is but obvious that the distance with C, that is the centroid of cluster 2, is less. So the D point will be there in cluster 2, right? When we have divided the data, it was there in cluster 2 only, and now also it remains there only. Fine? So now, what should we do? Calculate new centroids. As such, there is no movement, so we should not go further. But if any other data is there, we can say that we should find the new centroids. So that's what I am showing you for C1. Now, what will be the new centroid? That is equal to 1 plus 2 divided by 2, comma. This you have to show, right? When you can say no movement is there. But for that, we have to show 1 plus 2 divided by 2 because we are finding the centroid. First of all, we have assumed that. Okay. First of all, we have assumed that A is the centroid, and you can see that DC is the centroid for cluster 1 and cluster 2 respectively. Fine. So now what we are doing is we are finding the centroid of the clusters. So 1 plus 2 divided by 2, comma 1 plus 1 divided by 2. So we are finding the centroid of cluster 1. Same way we'll find the centroid of cluster 2. We know that just now we are having A and B points in cluster 1 and C and D points as in cluster 2. Right? So we are finding the centroid of C2 cluster. So 4 plus 5 divided by 2, 3 plus 4 divided by 2, and that is equal to 4.5 and 3.5. These are the centroids, right? Now with this, we'll find the distance of data points, right? So, now, for us, centroid is not A for 7, and centroid is not C for C2. So, we have to find the distance of each and every data point with C1 and C2. Fine? Okay. So, what we do is, we'll be finding the distance of A data with C1 centroid and distance of A point with C2. That is the centroid of cluster 2, which we have just found, right? By taking the average, right? We have found that here. So now, we'll be finding the distance of A with C1 and C2. Whichever is less distance, so point will remain or point will move to that particular cluster. Let us find the distance. That is under root of 1.5 minus 1. Now you have to consider the newly calculated centroid values, right? Do not consider the older one, which we have assumed. Fine? Okay. So, under root of 1.5 minus 1 square plus 1 minus 1 whole square. And that comes out to be 0.5. And for A with C2 distance is coming as 4.3, right? So, we can see that 0.5 is less than 0.3. 0.3? No, it is 4.3, right? So, what we say that A is nearer to the centroid C1 than C2, right? So, A remains in C1. Fine. Now, we'll do the same for data B. So, let us find that distance of D, that is distance D with what? B and C1. We are finding the distance of data B from C1 cluster and C2 cluster. Fine. So, for that, we can say 1.5 minus 2 whole square plus 1 minus 1 whole square. Same way here, we'll be having under root of 4.5 minus 2 whole square plus 3.5 minus 1 whole square, right? So, that is equal to 3.536, and here, it is 0.5. We can understand. It is very easily we can see that distance of B with C1 is less than that of distance of B with C2. Fine. So, B remains in C1. Fine. Proceed further. distance of C with C1 and distance of C with C2. Fine. So what happens? That 1.5 minus 4 whole square plus 1 minus 3 whole square. And here 4.5 minus 4 whole square plus 3.5 minus 1 whole square. So we are getting 3.2015, which is greater than 2.236. And so we can say distance of C with C1 is greater than distance of C with C2. And so C remains in C2. Proceed further. We'll find the distance of D with C1 and D with C2. So what happens? That we are getting the distance as 4.61 for C1 distance with D, and we can say D with C2, that is coming as 2.236. So which one is less? It is but obvious that distance with C2 is less for D point or D data. So D remains in C2. So no movement in points in cluster. If it is being moved, we have to again draw the cluster like this. And we have to show that A point is here. Suppose B is moving, so we'll have to put it here, right? But here, no movement is in the points. So we can say A, B will remain same in C1 and C, D will remain same in C2. Fine? So this is the simple example. Fine? This is simple example of clustering. We have to repeat this procedure. That means if movement was there, what we have to do is after the movement, whatever clusters are there, with those data points, we will again find the centroid. We'll again find the distance of each and every data point with C1 and C2. And we'll see whether movement is there or not. If movement is there, proceed further. Otherwise, stop at that point and we can say final clusters are there. It is very simple example, isn't it? So, it is clear. Let me give you summary once again so you can have the idea. What people used to do is, first of all, it is being assumed C. Now, in this example, I am saying you that we are assuming A as centroid of cluster 1 and C as centroid of cluster 2. In your exam, it can be given to you in the problem statement that B, suppose, is the centroid of cluster 1. And D, suppose, is the centroid of cluster 2. So you will have to consider those points as the cluster centroids. If it is specified, you can take that one. If it is not specified, you can assume yourself. Okay? And typically, we take it as first point as the centroid of the cluster 1. And say four data, so we can consider the third points. If more data points are there, equally divide it in two parts and first point in that will be the centroid. Okay, this way typically we calculate the example, but always keep the things in your mind. What is given in the problem statement? If it is being said that the calculate the centroid first. If it is being given, then you cannot assume the clusters like this. which are having the centroid point this way, then what you should have done is you can divide the data in two parts, find the centroid, that is take the average, and then after proceed further for finding the distances, right? So take care of this. This way you have to write. What you do is, first of all, you are assuming the cluster centroids. If are not given to you, then equally you have divided the parts. You can say, ma'am, if the 5 datas are there, then what to do? No issue. You can consider, say, 3 data points here and 2 data points here. Or otherwise, if you feel 2 comes first and 3 comes later, no issue. But typically, we are taking more, 5 are there. So equally, if we are trying to divide, that is not possible. So 3, that is major number, will come to C1, and minor number, that is 2, will come to C2. This is typically we are using, okay? It is not compulsory to take that way only, fine? So after that, we find the distance with cluster 1 and cluster 2 of each and every data point. Try to check which distance is less, whether the distance with cluster C1 centroid or cluster C2 centroid. Whatever is less, there will move the data point. And after that, if movement is there, you have to draw the clusters like this. In the starting also, we have said this is C1 where we are having the A and B points. And for C2, we are having C and D points. That way, if movement is there, you have to show that C1 in that these data points are there. In C2, these data points are there. Then after, you will find the centroid. And again, you will find the distances of each and every data point with C1 centroid and C2 centroid, which we have calculated. Okay. After finding the distances, if the points are moving, then we'll again have to find the centroids by calculating average. Okay. This procedure is repeated till no movement is there. Now, one more thing is, if very big example is there, like say you have to calculate is 10 times and then you are getting the clusters. So what you should do? See, read the problem statements. Many a times it is given that you have to go till 2 steps only, 3 steps only. So you have to consider that. Fine? Do not calculate the whole example. Fine? So read the problem statement properly and calculate the example. Fine? Okay. So this was with the handwritten example, the way we can write it in the paper. This is the Excel sheet example. For your theory assignments, you will have to calculate this way, right? You can write it the way I have shown you handwritten example, but for Excel sheet, all of you have to make at least one Excel sheet for one batch, 2-3 Excel sheet I must be getting, right, for the submission. So, what was that? Say the data here, 7 subjects are given, A and B. You may consider they are the credits or whatever you want to. Fine. So the data is given 1, 1, 1.52. This way the data is given. Now here, assume the initial cluster means, that is the centroids, are C1, 1, 1, and C2, 5, 7. So 7 datas are there, right? So what we have done is almost 3 data points we have considered in cluster 1 and other 4 we have considered for cluster 2. Fine. They are now 3 points in cluster 1 and 4 points in cluster 2, right? So it is not equal, but odd number of data is there, then what to do, isn't it? Okay, so no issue for that. You can have 3 or 4, it depends on you. Have that. Now, say cluster 1, what is the mean? A and B, we can say 2 coordinates are there. So 1, 1, or you can say 1, 1, right? For cluster 2, 5 and 7, fine. So proceed further. Now, what we have to do is, data item is there and we want to find the distance with cluster 1 and distance with cluster 2, fine? So we are finding the distance. Now that we need to calculate, it is same as the data item, so it is going to be 0 only, fine? Here, we are finding what formula we are using, that is, we can say, of Euclidean distance. Yeah, one more thing is, you should check it out. What is given in the problem statement? Is it given as the Euclidean distance or Manhattan distance or nothing is given? If nothing is given, you can say we are using Euclidean distance or Manhattan distance. But if it is specified, then you will have to consider what? That is, you can say whatever you want. Fine. Just a second. It is smaller. Let me make it bigger, right? So it will be clear to you. Fine. Okay. For this also, let me make it a bit bigger. Okay. So now you can see that, right? So what we do is, we are finding the distance, that is with centroid C1 and with centroid C2, right? Okay. So wherever the distance is less, the point will remain in this only. Wherever it is greater, it will move to other cluster. Fine. The concept remains same. I am just trying to show you that we are calculating the same thing using Excel sheet. Right? And you can recall also the clustering, k-means clustering algorithm. Fine. One more example we are looking at, isn't it? Now, so what happens that after finding the distances with the centroid of cluster 1 and cluster 2, we can say that for cluster 1, we are having the items 1, 2, 4, 5. What we were having before? We were having 1, 2, 3 in cluster 1 and 4, 5, 6, 7 as in cluster 2. But now after this, we are having the movement. So we'll be saying it as 1, 2, 4, 5 is there in cluster 1. And in cluster 2, we are having 3, 6, 7 items. Right? As we were drawing the ellipse and showing the items. You can say, what is this 1, 2, 3, 5? That is the subjects, right? Which were given here. Right? This is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Right? And if it is not given, you can give names yourself, right? But that you have to say, okay? We are writing this data and the name as this one, okay? That you have to say, otherwise, who can understand, right? So, we'll find this way. Then we can say we have to find the cluster mean again. That is the centroid we'll be finding, right? So as we have said that these are the clusters, after that we can say that we have to find the cluster mean with these points. Cluster 2 mean or centroid with these points, right? So we are calculating that for A and B coordinates. Here also for A and B coordinates, we know that finding mean is just doing the summation of those data points divided by that many numbers, right? Is known to us, fine? So that's what we are doing. After that, we again have to find the distance with cluster 1 and cluster 2. So that's what we are doing here. We'll check the, what we can say is, we'll check the distances, where it is more, where it is less, right? So that's what we'll do. And we can say that we have to see which data items will remain in cluster 1 and which data items will be there in cluster 2, right? So what we'll see that after doing all this, we can say that cluster 1 items are 1, 2, 4, 5 and cluster 2 items are 3, 6, 7. What they seem? If no, we'll have to find the cluster means again, right? Again find the distance, again see what are the cluster items, right? So proceed till you can say no movements are there. You can say, ma'am, here the movement is there, still you have stopped here. Why is it so? Because for this particular example, it was given that go till say third level or fourth level. If it is given that way, till that only you have to go and do not proceed further, right? So you can say, let me minimize this a bit so you can see it properly, fine? What happens? Yeah, now you can see, first of all, what we have done was, this was given, right? Data was given, we have assumed the cluster centroid. After that, we can say that we have considered the distance with cluster 1 and cluster 2. It is there here, right? Distance with cluster 1 and cluster 2, fine? Then we have moved the points with the cluster 1 and cluster 2 if the distances with the centroid are less, right? Again, we have calculated the centroids, right? With whatever data points now we are having. Now again we'll find the distance, fine? Very simple things are there, right? So first we have done, this is second time we are doing. Then you can say this is third time we are doing, right? So if it is given that three times you should try it or till three levels you should go, you should calculate like this, okay? Otherwise, you have to calculate it till the no movements in the data points from cluster 1 to cluster 2 and cluster 2 to cluster 1 are there, right? No movement should be there, fine? Okay. So now, this is the way we can calculate the clustering example. Which clustering example? K means clustering example, where k is already given to us, that was k is equal to 2. This we have calculated with the Euclidean distance. Now if we want to calculate the same with Manhattan distance, what we have to do is, we know that what is the formula for that? That is y2 minus y1 mod of y2 minus y1 plus mod of x2 minus x1, right? This is what is known to us, isn't it? This is known to us. I'm just making it bigger so you can see the formula properly, right? Okay, this is the formula which is known to us for Manhattan distance. So what we can do is, we'll find the distances with this formula, okay? So let me show you that. See, procedure remains same, okay? Procedure remains same. Only thing is, we are calculating the distance with this method now. That is Manhattan distance, right? So, same things are there. Say, we are assuming that 1, 2, 3 items are there in cluster 1 and 4, 5, 6, 7 are there in cluster 2, right? So cluster 1 items are 1, 2, 3, cluster 2 items are 4, 5, 6, 7. So what we do? What we do? Cluster 1 mean we are finding. Now you can say that why are you calculating this first cluster mean? Because in this problem statement, it is mentioned that calculate the mean first. Or you can say nothing is given. That you should assume that the cluster 1 mean is this one. And cluster 2 mean is this one. It is not given. So what to do? You can assume it that this is a centroid. Or otherwise, it is preferred. You can calculate the mean because data points are there. Data is there. If it is being given in the problem statement that you have to assume the mean, you have to assume and then after you should proceed further. Otherwise, you should calculate the mean at this point only. You can say, ma'am, yes, this you should see. If it is given in the problem statement that you have to assume this centroids for cluster 1 and cluster 2 are there, you have to consider those only. If it is not given, you can assume. Otherwise, you can calculate, right? So from this point only, we have calculated. This is what we haven't done yet. Yes, but for this example, we are doing that. This distance we are finding using, means this cluster's distance with data points, we will be finding with the Manhattan distance, right? Manhattan distance. It is up to you whether to consider Euclidean or Manhattan if nothing is specified. But if it is specified, you have to consider that only. Okay? If it is given that you have to use Euclidean distance and if you are using Manhattan, though 100% calculation is proper, you will not get marks for that. Okay? So take care of that. Read the problem statement properly. So you can see we have found the centroid. Now proceed further. That is, we have to find the distances of all data items with cluster centroids. So they are here. You can say, how do we find? Here in Excel sheet, we can say that we'll have to have the absolute value, isn't it? You can see that. I'll zoom a bit so you can see it bigger, right? Okay, so you can see that, right? Wherever your data points are there, you can take that value, isn't it? Fine. Okay, so distances you are finding. After that, what you have to do is you have to check whether the distance is less or greater, right? And wherever it is less, the data point will be in that cluster and it will not move through the other. But if it is, say, here, this is the data item 3, but here we have seen that it is greater distance than the distance with C2. So we know that we'll move this data item to cluster C2, right? Wherever the movement is there, those things, that means the data items will move there, and we have to show that after all this calculation, what are the cluster 1 items and what are the cluster 2 items. Fine. Again, we'll have to find the mean. So find the mean. After that, again find the distance. See the comparison. See whether they are moving or not. You can say cluster items are 1 and 2 and cluster 2 items are 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So they are same as the previous step. So the final clusters are cluster 1 items, they are 1 and 2 and cluster 2 items are 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Right? See, the same example was there, which we have calculated using cluster 1, sorry, Euclidean distance and Manhattan distance. Fine. But it was different for if we are taking Euclidean distance and if we are taking Manhattan distance, right? So no need to worry for that. Whatever is given in the problem statement, you should take that, right? So no worries. And this is what we have seen is the K-means clustering algorithm, right?